I'll do 10 more. Money check.
Well, I've been a physical culturist all my life. I started in when I was 12 years old. And I've been exercising and training ever since. It's a way of life with me. And I'd be doing it whether I were a sculptor or not. But it helps my sculpting. It helps my painting. It helps everything I do because it gives me a margin of strength. Physical activity, there's an old saying, it takes money to make money. And there's a saying, it takes strength to build strength and maintain strength. You must exert your muscles and you must teach your body to be able to cope with more than it's called upon to cope with in daily activity. Otherwise, your strength leaves you, and pretty soon the effort of living becomes too much. Sculpting is very tiring because it's physical work, especially if you carve marble and you make large statues. There is the aspect of physical endurance. An artist can have all the talent in the world, but if he doesn't have the strength, the endurance, and the guts to back it up, he's not going to create anything. He's going to sit around and dream about what he would create all the time. But the work of art first takes form in the artist's mind. And then the distance from the mind to the tangible manifestation of that work in this physical world of ours takes a lot of hard work and a lot of sweat.
Try a little more.
One becomes in a frame of mind where there's a constant challenge to maintain strength and fitness. And without that challenge, life would be rather dull, I think.
When your eyes look down, hold it now. China is my model. Most perfect model I've ever been able to find. I painted her in just about every role that a movie actress could be in. I've even painted her as a negress. But she's remarkable. She can hold a pose for a tremendous length of time without resting. Turn it more.
Not for my talent, and just for my beauty. Huh, that's really, I'm asked that all the time. Mm-hmm. In fact, at not too long ago, at a store, a lady comes up to me and she says, you know, she says, I saw you. And I said, you did? She says, yes, I saw you at the ceiling of the MGM. She says, how does it feel to be naked? How does your husband like you to see you naked around? I said, that I am not naked. I'm not a centerfold. I'm a piece of art.
Turn your body to the left. Your more.
Not your head, just your body. Leave your head back. You can't do that, can you? Rest. Painter, in striving to create the dimension of depth on a two-dimensional plane, is actually thinking as a sculptor thinks. You must think in terms of mass in space, a three-dimensional mass occupying space. If he doesn't think this way and feel this way, then his paintings never take on the illusion of depth.
He's not a camera, he does not just record literally. So the artist employs the elements of exaggeration, caricature, minimization. He minimizes certain things at the expense of other things in order to most effectively, forcefully make his statement. Now, if he doesn't do this, he usually winds up with a photographically literal work. I started out, I took a lot of training as an illustrator. And to be an illustrator, you have to be very exacting and accurate. It seems like I've been drawing and painting all my life. I was studying oil painting with a private tutor when I was 9 years old. I was studying wood carving when I was 10. And at 16, I was dissecting with a medical student in a laboratory studying anatomy. So it's been a lifetime thing for me. I can't really remember when I wasn't drawing. The difference between an artist and the layman is that the artist has the ability to capture an experience in stone or paint or music or words, and through his work he communicates with other human beings so that they can participate in that experience with him. If the observer or the listener has to say, what is it, then the artist has failed, really. Although there are many artists who say, if you don't understand my work, it's your fault. But in reality, it's the artist's first job, responsibility, to communicate to his audience. Now, the audience doesn't have to agree with him, but if he understands what he's saying, then he has created a work of art.
Fencing has been a hobby of mine ever since my days in college. I'm more or less a maverick. My interest has been in the rapier. In my mind, this is a true sword, the true weapon.
All right, yeah. Very good.
That's a girl. I'm on this hand. Hand me this brick.
Don't bounce.
No. All right. Now, when you go over here, as soon as you get in position, go for that brick.
Go for this brick?
No, this one over here.
The act evolved from adagio dancing to a combination act. I used to do acrobatic dancing and then finish off with the balancing. And for many years I did this type of thing. And then I conceived of the idea of performing the act with a hazard element, the swords.
Good job.
Thank you.
first started it, I was projecting fear to the audience, and you could see it, and you mustn't do that, because I feel that he is in such control that he knows what he's doing. So therefore, fear has no place in a performance. It probably does subconsciously, right? And when you're through and it's all over, you say, wow, good.
Behind the inferno. The idea was to create a dimensional painting, and I'm well on the way to doing that. But when it's completed, you'll be surrounded by the inferno. You will look down into the pit and up into the ceiling of the pit. And there will be a third dimension to what would ordinarily be a two-dimensional medium. Of course, I selected the subject because the subject has been with man since the beginning, when he started to feel the first rustlings of a conscience. He started to consider moral concepts and consider right from wrong, good from bad, and in so doing, he reserved a place in the dim recesses of his mind of atonement for his transgressions. The idea of an inferno, a hell, has been with man from the beginning because of this. But still, the idea remains the same. A place of atonement for our wrongdoing. About that. Pictures of these statues go all over the world, wherever the tourist homes are. People are always asking me, why does it take so long? That's understandable. Why they should ask that question. But they don't realize that this is made inch by inch. And
There are no shortcuts. If I were to stop work right now, the statue would remain forever in an unfinished state. And in the final analysis, when I finally put my chisel down and say it's finished, world, the only thing that matters is what the world can see. And how fast or how slowly it was created doesn't mean a thing. Of course, I have the privilege of putting my name on it, but with that goes the responsibility. So that's why I'm quite particular about what I put my name on. The model for this statue is gargantuan. The great gorilla was Ringling Brothers for many years. Probably the greatest circus attraction of all time. And I used to watch him in his cage, and I was fascinated by his tremendous strength. He wasn't as large as this, of course, but he was built in these proportions. Tremendous arms. Didn't have the rotund proportions that most gorillas in captivity attain. He was a real macho man, gargantuan. Didn't recognize.
Well, Doug, what do you think about this one? This is the sweepstakes winner, the best commercial float enter, Icoa Life Insurance Company.
All these gladiators here are carrying the shields, the spears, they have the armor on, and the shin guards of the gladiators, and that drummer with the big kettle drum, and they also have makeup on their faces to give them that hue. And here we come with some more drummers and some more saber bearers. And this thing goes a whole block and a half. Ivan, is what you call fast.
Drummond Fiesta is his theme, taking off, of course, on the Arab Leopard.
I've always liked the pretty girls in the parade, but I've never seen anything like this. This has got the pretty girls in it. It's got every band.
And animals. On this boat, home at Nature's Heaven in the Animal Training Center north of Hollywood, 4 years old, been raised in captivity since 8 weeks, recently featured in the movie The Lion. And according to his trainer, this is the first time a lion has been used on a float. He was in the lobby of the Benson Hotel here, too. Made quite a few.
Hey, look at these fellas with the muscles. Boy, this is a production, to say the least.
These are professional weightlifters and models. Costumes are authentic. Much, much preparation went into this to make it look as authentic and as real as possible.
I got to work out more with LaFrenzy.
Watch that whip. He's a real slave driver.
There's more of this to come.
And still it comes. The Icoa Life Insurance Company float. Sweepstakes, best commercial winner.
Ivan, this is not just a block and a half long. This right now is stretching out over almost 4 blocks. And I was just talking to Lee Jenks at the Benson Hotel, and he said this is like Pasadena. This is more than Pasadena. Pasadena's big parade has never seen anything to compare with this float here.
This final float bears Cleopatra, Caesar, fighting gladiators, and our lion we told you about, and crucified criminals. Oh, boy.
The Rose Festival has to take a back seat to no one.
Look at that lion. Lion there so calmly.
I'd say the only thing that isn't on this is Liz Taylor.
Pretty good reproduction on top.
Then we have Rome, you know.
They look pretty happy about it. Well, they should be.
See that lion.